Good afternoon, Facebook Live. This is Robin Kirby Ghetto. Welcome to today. It's going to be an awesome day in the Lord. Amen. As you join on, be hopeful and expectant that God is going to strengthen you with a new anointing, a fresh anointing. That is one of my favorite things. Matthew 5:6, be hungry and thirsty for righteousness. Why? Blessed are those that are hungry and thirsty for righteousness. Why? They shall be what? Filled. And so as you join on, saints of God, be hopeful and expectant. The Holy Spirit is going to just meet you right where you are, and you're just going to be filled with the joy of the Lord, which is your strength in Jesus' name. Amen. And I know a few people have said that they've had issues in trying to sign on my Facebook Lives the last couple of times. You just keep trying, and God will connect you. And also, you will be able to see it after I do the broadcast. Hey, Barbara Voigt, I love you. Thank you for joining in, woman of God. So awesome to have you on here. And as you join in, oh my goodness, Holy Spirit is going to strengthen us. Amen, Sue. I love you. Thank you for joining in. I also see a few more people joining in. Hey, Susan Sawicki, God bless you. It is going to be an awesome day. And oh my goodness, we just celebrated Yom Kippur, and now we're going into the Feast of Tabernacles this weekend. How awesome is that? Are y'all super excited? Hey, Lisa, I love you. Thank you for joining in. Hey, Sheila, so awesome to have you on here. God bless you. And we are just going to seek the Lord in earnestness, and we are going to find him. Amen. Luke 11, just ask, keep on asking, seek, keep on seeking, and knock, keep on knocking, and the door shall be opened in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, Mary, God bless you. Hey, Deborah, so good to see you on here, and we are going to have an awesome time. Oh, thank you, Lisa. I love you. You are so precious. I love you and your precious jewels. God, we just thank you for Holy Spirit. We thank you, Father, that you are able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we can think or hope, according to that power and operation inside of us, as you do exceedingly abundantly, above what we can think or imagine. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you, Deborah. Thank you for joining in. And we are going to look at the necessity of guarding our heart diligently. We are still seeking the Lord in earnestness, in prayer, and in fasting as Holy Spirit leads you. And we are speaking life abundantly. John 10:10, Jesus came to bring life and life abundantly. What happened? The enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy, but Jesus Christ comes to bring life and life abundantly. And we're going to keep looking at the issue of fruit in regards to, hey, Kathy, in regards to the area of the kingdom of heaven that is in our midst. God is going to give us an anointing of eye salve to open our eyes so that we can see the presence of the kingdom of heaven in our midst. And we're going to get to a couple of scriptures. We're going to look at the different dynamics as it relates to the anointing of grace that is being poured out in this hour, and it is really to open our eyes, to remove areas that we have not been able to see. And one of the things I love about the Father is there is such a gentle conviction of Holy Spirit that is that Hebrews 4:12 that just goes into our motives and on our intentions as we are seeking him in fasting and prayer, and he is bringing such tentativeness that we are circumspect. We are yielding to wisdom in this hour, as it says in Hebrews 4:12 through 16, that we are able to see that which has been laid bare, and we're going to get into that, and that which has been made naked before the Lord, so that we're not trying to get our own fig leaves and cover anything up, right? That God is just bringing such a grace to lay everything bare in front of our eyes, that we have the word, we are equipped, we're able to deal with it by Holy Spirit, for God to go to that place and to let us know our need for the great physician, our need for mercy. And that is when we run to the throne of grace boldly, Hebrews 4:16, to obtain mercy in our time of need. And so God has us looking at a lot of things today. Oh my goodness. He's already bringing in Revelation. He's bringing in Hebrews. He's bringing in Romans 12:1. He's bringing in Luke 11. And so we have got so much expectancy by Holy Spirit, and I cannot wait to see what God is going to do today. And so let's look at Revelation 3, and we're looking at the church that he is counseling to get gold refined in the fire. And it is the church of Laodicea. The church of Laodicea. And I am not comparing us to the church of Laodicea, but God is getting to a point here, right? There are areas of our soul that resist the works of Holy Spirit. And that is where the stronghold is. That is why 2 Corinthians 10, 4 through 8 talks about taking every thought captive. And also in Romans 12, 1, scripture says that we are to come forth and in a place of consecrating our body, making a decisive dedication over it in order to consecrate it in Jesus' name. Amen, Joy. And I actually talk about shame and about covering in shame in my book, At His Feet, which is on Amazon, and it is absolutely phenomenal. Get that. There's a whole chapter on shame and rejection. And so let's look specifically, and we're going to bring up the Greek as we look at the Strong's Concordance as well, in the scriptures in the New Testament. And God is just going to bring us such knowledge, wisdom, and understanding. Hey, Andrea. Hey, Kim Mitchell. God bless y'all. Thank you for joining in. And so let us look, as I pull up scripture, at Revelation 3. Revelation 3. And God has us going to the place of the church of Laodicea. Not that we're going to look at all of this, but we're going to look at an aspect, because I know those of y'all who are on here are like me, and you are earnest seeking holiness. You are earnest and humbling yourself, amen? And so we're looking at Revelation 3, and we look at verse 14 as scripture by Jesus Christ brings the warning to the church of Laodicea. And we're going to take an aspect out of this, which is verse 18. But in order to understand verse 18, we have to see it in context. Amen. A lot of people do not realize, especially as it relates to scripture, that it's always in context. And one of the things that Holy Spirit had me do in the 2 Timothy 2 teaching for the Watchmen series in 2014, and the saints came marching in, was he had me teach on the chiastic structure. And some of y'all have heard me talk about the chiastic structure, and the Bible is taught in a chiastic structure. And so chiastic structure actually comes from the Greek letter chi, which is an X, and that chiastic structure has three components, and you see this in Jesus' teachings in the New Testament. And so the ingredients for a chiastic structure are, number one, I'm going to tell you what I'm going to teach you. Number two, I'm going to teach you. And then number three, I'm going to tell you what I just taught you. And so theologians have dissected the Word of God from Genesis to Revelation. There is a chiastic structure. Jesus taught in a chiastic structure, and every time he taught his disciples, as you see in the New Testament in the Gospels, he tells them what he's going to teach them, then he teaches them in a parable, and then he tells them what he just taught them. And so that is the chiastic structure. And so as we look at Revelation 3:18, and Holy Spirit just brings us strength to know that God is going to cause us to walk circumspect. He's going to cause us to walk in wisdom. So the devil cannot trip us up, but that we will stand resolutely in the power of Christ, knowing the abundant life that God has called us to, as we do not yield to the wiles of the devil. You have to get it through your knower, church. The enemy is not going to attack you outside of the church to get you discouraged, to pull you into deception. He is not going to do that. The enemy, he connived his way into the garden. He connived his way into the church. And so you have to be circumspect. You have to walk in prudence. You have to know when God is telling you words to say and when not to say. And you have to be on the wise and understand when the enemy is operating and walk in discernment. And that is by having the eye salve upon your eyes to where you know your need. You know your need. You know your need. You know your need. And we're going to see especially how Holy Spirit comes according to the need. Now, I have a teaching on my YouTube channel. The time is 11:11, and I talk about Luke 11, and I talk about Isaiah 11. I talk about Holy Spirit, but God really emphasizes the Lord's Prayer and Jesus doing the Lord's Prayer, and here's that chiastic structure, and right behind it, Jesus does a parable. He does a teaching, and then he tells the disciples what he just taught them, and so it is always in context. So let us enter into this time in context to understand what the Spirit of God is saying. Amen. So Revelation 3, verse 14. And the angel messenger of the assembly church in Laodicea write, these are the words of the Amen. Woo, don't you love that? The trusty and faithful and true witness. Woo! The origin and beginning and author of God's creation. I know your record of works and what you're doing. Now understand, when Jesus is saying, I know your record of works, he's saying, I know your fruit, because fruit equals works. See, they can be doing works on the outside that have a form of godliness, but deny the power of it. Deny the power of the transformation. And that is what the Word of God has always been about, is the atoning blood of Christ Jesus that transforms mankind into the holiness of God Almighty. And that is the strength of the name of the Lord that we lean upon, amen. That is the transformation. That is the metamorphosis, amen. Like we see with the caterpillar into the butterfly. And there is an earnestness about this where the enemy tries to get us in our own works. And in those own works, it is ungodly fruit, and it is by our might. And then we get into a works concept and we deny grace, and it all becomes about us and what we can do. And we're caught up in pride, and we have left the floor of humility, and we are lifted up in our own strength. And this is what Jesus Christ is addressing to the church of Laodicea. He is saying, listen to the Amen, to the trustworthy witness, God himself, Jesus Christ, who is the author, the beginner, and the finisher of our faith. He knows our record of works. And again, this is not to bring condemnation. Listen, saints of God, in the last week, you should have been through the greatest assault, probably most likely, in your Christian walk to date, because all of hell was coming against the saints and was operative, making us think we were unclean, that we were condemned, the spirit of condemnation, the accuser, the slanderer, Satan. That's what Satan means. And so he was operative off the chain like that last week, as he was when Jesus Christ warned Peter in Luke 22, as Jesus already says to them, listen, y'all are those that have remained with me and have endured in my trials, in the Word's trials, in Jesus's trials. And so as my Father has appointed unto me a kingdom, so do I appoint unto you. And right after he says that, immediately he looks at Simon, and he doesn't call him Peter. He says, Simon, Satan has asked permission to sift all of you like grain, but I've already prayed that when you return, you will strengthen the brethren. Hallelujah. And what is that strength? That is that Matthew 16. As you look at the keys of the kingdom from chapter Matthew 16 to Matthew 19, as you see the abounding grace of God revealed, and that is the righteousness of Christ Jesus. Our strength in battle, our strength in warfare, our strength in everything we do, will always be one thing and one thing alone, and that is the righteousness of Christ Jesus. That is the new wine that is poured into wineskins that have been stretched and are prepared for the new anointing. Amen. And you have to understand this through the concept where God is going to remove scales from our eyes today. Hallelujah. And He is going to bring a greater strength to cause us to abound in truth, to know our need, hallelujah, for the great physician, amen. Now, I know that we are so excited about this, so God bring it on in Jesus' name. Verse 15, I know your record of works and what you're doing. You're neither hot, nor you're neither cold nor hot. What that you are cold or hot, so because you are lukewarm, neither cold or hot, I will spew you out of my mouth. For you say, I am rich. Now, we're going to see how this applies to us today, because again, God is making us aware of our condition. We know that we are nothing without Christ Jesus. And if you've gone through the last week of warfare, you feel like a stump. Isaiah 6:13. That the remnant will be a stump. That is what it says in Hebrew. The remnant will be a stump. That God was warning. He was letting the prophet Isaiah know, listen, Isaiah, I've got to circumcise you. First of all, Isaiah, you think you're altogether that righteous? When you see the glory of God, Isaiah, and you're so quick to condemn, you're going to understand that I'm going to meet you with a love that is going to undo you so that you don't curse the remnant. Because the remnant is going to look just like those that are going into the way of destruction. And you have to be discerning. And you're going to discern by the language of their fruit. That is how you're going to discern. That even though the remnant are going through this place of just utter stripping and sifting, they're actually like that. As Scripture proclaims in Malachi 4, they are not cursing God, but they are thanking on the name of the Lord. And they're thanking on how awesome He is. And they are talking about how awesome God is. And that when this anointing comes forth, they are going to go out of the old season into the new season like calves leaping out of the stall in the spring and just running over the ashes of the wicked. And saints of God, that is how it is going to be. We are going to be in such a season of knowing fruit. There is a greater discernment by Holy Spirit to know our fruit and to know the fruit of others. So we are discerning, amen. And so let's look at verse 17. For you say, I am rich, I've prospered, and I've grown wealthy. Do you understand the saints of God? The measuring line of the unclean, of the Laodicea church, is they're measuring how blessed they are in the world. That their measure of riches, of saying, listen, I don't need God because I'm wealthy, I'm blessed. That is a trick of the enemy. It is a trick of the enemy. And if you have ever read the book of Enoch, oh my goodness, you will tremble. You will tremble. God gave me the book of Enoch when it came into my life in the 2000s, but He told me to buy it. You can actually read it online. He told me to buy it, and I got it for a Christmas gift. The Christmas gifts I got were this Amplified Classic Bible in 2009, some pearls, and the book of Enoch. That's all I wanted for Christmas. Those were the three things I wanted for Christmas, and Rich got them for my Christmas present. And every now and then, Holy Spirit, and I've written about the book of Enoch in some of my teachings and some of my workbooks, and every time Holy Spirit goes me to the book of Enoch, He is always pointing at the prophecies where Enoch talks about a group of people that are going to be deceived with the riches of this world. Riches, money. It is going to be the spirit of mammon. And this is what we see with the Laodicea church. Amen, Matt, is that they say, listen, I'm rich, I've prospered, I've grown wealthy. Look, I'm blessed. I don't need anything. And you do not realize and understand that you're wretched, you're pitiable, you're poor, you're blind, and you're naked. Therefore, I counsel you to purchase from me gold refined and tested by fire, that you may be truly wealthy. Your wealth does not come from outside of your person. True wealth in Christ Jesus is inside of you and is the substance of faith, hallelujah, the emotional experience, hallelujah, that will get you through all of hell, that will get you through the stripping, that will get you through the sifting, where you can be like that wild ox on the threshing floor in Micah 4, 12 and 13, where scripture says, yes, Zion, they curse you, but they do not know the plans of the Lord God for you. For I will lift you up off the threshing floor. And he talks about the wild ox's horn of iron and bronze feet. And he will bring the enemy like sheaves under the feet of the wild ox. And that wild ox represents the wealth of the righteousness of Christ Jesus. Do you understand the deceptions of this present age and the spirit of mammon and where the enemy wants to trip us up? He wants us to get us in self-righteousness, which are garments that are filthy. They're filthy rags. He wants us to get us in our own works. And this is why God has allowed the attack of the enemy, so that you know that inside of yourself, you are nothing without Christ Jesus. You know you are pitiable. You are utterly dependent. You know your need. Your heart has been opened. And God the Father has brought wisdom from above and has lifted you up on the highway of holiness, Isaiah 35:8, to let you know a higher way, a holy way. And this is what we see, that the church of Laodicea has a false holiness. It is a man-made holiness. And Holy Spirit is waking us up, because Holy Spirit can only flow through those vessels of mercy, Romans 9:23, that have been created for God's glory. And God is preparing us to be a vessel of mercy. I remember in about 2004, 2003, that God had my first message in a women's meeting, me talk about being a walking mercy seat. And I love this. I absolutely love this. And God showed me a split screen of this as he was having me teach. And it was about Romans 9:23, a vessel of mercy created for God's glory. There are both ignoble and there are awesome, great vessels of honor created that are in God's house. In fact, let us go to that to get a better understanding. Amen. So we're looking at Romans 9 and we're going to verse 23 to get an understanding. And understand that these vessels have to go through the fire. Amen. And that is when you find out their character. That is when you find out what substance they are made of. Amen. Romans 9:23. And what if he thus purposes to make known and show the wealth of his glory? Oh my goodness. I just want to jump out of this chair. Oh my goodness. Put the brakes on. Let's now go back to Romans 9:23. And then we're going to go to Revelation 3 again. Because what is God talking about? Look, you either have the wealth of this world, the spirit of mammon, or you either are submitted unto God and he is your wealth. Amen. So let's look at Romans 9:23. And what if he thus purposes to make known and show the wealth of his glory in dealing with the vessels and objects of his mercy, which he has prepared beforehand for glory? Is that not amazing? In fact, let's go back to verse 21, and we're going to see these two distinctions. You're going to see the Laodicea church and those given over to a spirit of mammon, and you're going to see those that are going through the sifting and being prepared for glory. Amen. So Romans 9, let's go to verse 21. Has the potter no right over the clay to make out of the same mass of lump one vessel for beauty and distinction and honorable use, and another for menial, ignoble, and dishonorable use? What if God, although fully intending to show the awfulness of his wrath and to make known his power and authority, has tolerated with much patience the vessels, the object of his anger, which are ripe for destruction? And what if he thus purposes to make known and show the wealth of his glory in dealing with the vessels and the objects of his mercy, which he has prepared beforehand for his glory, even including ourselves, whom he has called, not only from among the Jews, but also the Gentiles? Do you see this, Satan's of God? God is calling a people that know that inside of themselves, they have no righteousness in their person except for the righteousness of Christ Jesus. And this people group has been so sifted. They have been so sifted by Satan. See, a lot of you have to comprehend this from this aspect, okay? Because this will open up such a greater dynamic of understanding. When God told me years ago, as I was preaching about Peter's sifting, in Luke 22, God told me, he said, Robin, I want to show you a new dynamic about Peter's sifting. I said, okay. And he said, understand this. Peter was tormented. And I said, okay, God, show me more. I'm listening. And he said, you have to understand who Peter had to compare himself with. And I said, okay, who was it, God? And he said, Judas. And I went, oh my goodness. And God said, yes, Satan had gotten Peter in the place of sifting because he came at Peter and he was telling Peter he was just like Judas. He was just like Judas. And I was like, oh my goodness, I would be absolutely tormented if the only thought I had in my sifting was I was just like Judas, the son of perdition. And God said, yes, and that is why Peter left ministry. And it took Jesus to restore Peter to ministry. And the one question that Jesus Christ asked Peter in John 21 was, Peter, do you love me? Woo! Do you have a strong affection for me? Do you understand this, saints of God? Because a lot of people look at Peter sifting and they're thinking, you know, they cannot comprehend what it is about. And I am telling you, because I've been through this. When you go through a sifting like Peter, the enemy, the accuser, the slanderer is going to come at you and is going to tell you you are unworthy, you are unclean, you are like Judas, you are the last person that God can use, and you have to be on the wise, and you have to stay in a low estate, hallelujah, and know that outside of yourself, that within your person, there is only one thing within you, and that is the righteousness of Christ Jesus. And you know how pitiable, woo! You know how much you lack, hallelujah, and how you need to be visited by the glory of God. And in that humble estate, hallelujah, he will lift you up on the mighty wings to know a higher way, to know the ways of God, and to walk in holiness, hallelujah. And this, woo, saints of God, is when your eyes are open to see Matthew 11, 12, and 13, the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God, and the fruit therein, and to eat and to taste of that fruit, and to know the goodness of that fruit, the banner of love that protects you in the time of the scorching heat, hallelujah. Isaiah 4, 5, and 6, Song of Solomon 2, 4, where you are kept. Woo! And he feeds you with the holy cakes. Hallelujah. Those raisin cakes that are in the place of holiness. The only substance by which you are fed is the holiness of God. God just keeps bringing all these scriptures to me, and I'm speaking from all of these scriptures out of my belly, from the overflow, hallelujah. And I'm speaking from those scriptures, Isaiah 4, 5, and 6, Song of Solomon 2, 4 through 6, amen. And so let's look at Revelation 3, and let's look at verse 18 again. And this is our emphasis, amen. This is our emphasis. Therefore, I counsel you to purchase from me gold refined in the fire. Woo! Purchase it. Hallelujah. This cannot be bought by the currency and the wealth of this present age. This is bought, hallelujah, by the blood of Christ Jesus, which we have submitted to for the atoning works he has done for our sin and nailing it to his cross. Amen. Therefore, I counsel you to purchase from me gold refined and tested by fire, that you may be truly wealthy. Do you see this? It is all about true wealth. Oh my goodness. Are you excited that you came on today? And white clothes. Woo! Wash our garments, Jesus. Help us, God. Oh my goodness. I just want to run. And white clothes to clothe you and to keep the shame of your nudity from being seen. And salve to put on your eyes that you may see. Those whom I love dearly, I tell their faults and convict and convince and reprove and chasten. I discipline and instruct them. So be enthusiastic and in earnest and burning with zeal and repent, changing your mind and your attitude. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears and listens and heeds to my voice to open the door, I will come in and I will eat with him. Woo! And he will eat with me. For he who overcomes is victorious. I will grant him to sit beside me on my throne. This is what he said in Luke 22 to his disciples. As I myself overcame, was victorious, and sat down with my Father on his throne, he who is able to hear, let him listen to what the Holy Spirit says to the assembly churches. Amen. So let's get into some of the Greek. We're going to look at wealth, and we're going to look at this exposure that God brings into our heart. Amen. And so this word, Laodicea, it means inhabitants of Laodicea. And in Greek, it means justice of the people. Justice of the people. It's made out of compound word laos. Laos actually means tribe, nation, and people. And then the second word that composes this is the Greek word dika. And it means custom, usage, judgment, punish, vengeance. Do you see this? It means a decision. It means execution. And so when we look at this, and isn't it crazy that we're going through a justice appointment right now, and we're in this transition, because what it is saying is that this is the people's justice. They have determined their own justice. They've determined their own rule. They've determined their own righteousness, and they're in that works. And God is removing our hand from being our own justice, our own deliverer, and God is having us look up to where our help comes from, and knowing there is only one deliverer. It is not by our power. It is not by our might, but it is by his Spirit. And this is what the prophet Zechariah understood to his prophecy to Zerubbabel. Zerubbabel was in this place. He had stopped building the temple, as we see in Zechariah and Haggai. He had stopped building the temple. The people stopped building the temple, and Haggai confronts them because they're just trying to put money in their own pockets. Is this not crazy with what is going on with the church in this hour? Is that there has been a standstill with the church as it has been with other things in the nation. And don't take this the wrong way. Please hear the pleadings of the Father. There is a change of direction in the church. And God is now showing us areas where we are trying to build our kingdom. And God is going to bring us strength, knowledge, and wisdom, and cause us to know His wealth so that we are being built up in our most holy faith. Because understand this, things are coming to which the Father is preparing us. Amen. And so we're looking at the enemy exposed in this area in a counterfeit religiosity, in self-righteousness, where there is, oh, I'm wealthy, I have need of nothing. No, listen, let me tell you, the baptism of Holy Spirit and fire, you cannot stand. You are on the floor weeping between the porch and altar, and you are crying out to God because your own heart has been opened up to you. And like the prophet Isaiah in Isaiah 6, you're saying, oh, woe is me. I am a man of unclean lips. I'm a woman of unclean lips. And understand, this is the time when Peter, when Job, when Isaiah, when other people in the Word of God are exposed to their own heart, to where they think they're fine, but there is a self-righteousness at work, resisting the work of God. And that is what is happening in this hour. And that is why God is allowing the sifting, so that we know, saints of God, that there is nothing good in us except for Christ Jesus, except for God. Amen. So let's look at this Greek word for wealth, that we see that we are brought into true wealth. Amen. So scripture says about this lukewarm church that they've increased in goods. And this word goods in Greek is pluteo. Pluteo, and I think of Pluto, the planet Pluto. You are far off. You are so off. It's not anything compared to the Word. You are so far away from the Word, and you don't even realize how far away you have strayed away. That is what it makes me think of, pluteo. And it means wealthy. It means to be increased in goods. It means to be rich. And this comes from the Greek word plutizo. And plutizo means to make wealthy, and it means to enrich. So let's look as well at Romans 9, and let's see if this is the exact Greek word in Romans 9:23 about the vessels of mercy that were created for His glory, created for His riches. And so it is the Greek word plutos. And plutos, it comes from the same Greek word, but this is one word on top of that. It is a higher dimension, amen. And it means wealth as fullness. It also means possessions, abundance, riches, valuable, bestowment. And this actually comes from a different Greek word. Oh my goodness, plutos. I know it sounds familiar to the Greek word we just used. In fact, let us go back to that Greek word, because we're going to see the comparisons. They're not the same word. Even though they sound just a little similar, let us go back, amen. So the Greek word that I just got through doing in Laodicea in Revelation 3 is pluteo. And pluteo actually means increase with goods, to wax wealthy, to grow wealthy, become wealthy. And the particular Greek word actually used in Romans 9:23 is plutos, and it means possessions, riches, fullness of wealth. It means bestowment, and it comes from a different Greek word, pimplemi. Pimplemi, and it actually means to fill. Woo! To furnish, to fulfill, to accomplish. Woo! Do you hear this? The vessels of mercy have been so stripped from the things of this present age, and knowing that there's anything good in themselves except for Christ Jesus, as they have been sifted, that they are filled. They are fulfilled with the accomplishments, the works, John 14:12, of God, His fruit. Do you see this, saints of God? And they are, their thoughts are from above, as in Malachi 4, where their thoughts are on God. And they're not saying, God, why have you done this to me? God, why have you done that to me? They are saying, God is good all the time. And all the time, God is good. Do you understand? There's a transition shift, because all that they acknowledge is the accomplishment of the joy of their salvation. And that is one thing alone. It is the righteousness of Christ Jesus, that they are not going to take the gifts and traffic them. They're not going to traffic Holy Spirit, because they know in themselves they are inept. They don't look at how well they're doing and think that they got it themselves. They are addressed with the absolute fact of Hebrews 4:12. God has divided between their heart, their motives, and it has been laid bare. It has been opened and revealed to them, as they have been tested to the fire, and they are now covered in the garment of righteousness, because their heart has been laid bare, and they know their need for mercy, and they run to the throne of grace boldly, and they obtain it. Hallelujah. They know their need. Hallelujah. Jesus addressed the Pharisees, and he talked about those that would receive the power of Holy Spirit, and that God comes as a great physician to those that know their need. And this is where Luke 11 comes in. Because with the Lord's Prayer, Jesus gives the Lord's Prayer to his disciples. And he says, pray this way. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed, holy be thy name. Thy kingdom come. How's this kingdom going to come? If you see it, if you taste it, woo! If you eat at that table, Joel 2:26, if you're filled with that fruit, woo! And you're satisfied. Amen. And so as God brings that revealing, he's exposing areas of our heart to know our need. And this is what God is showing us. When we know our need, and this is what I always pray, as that prayer, that Lord's Prayer, shows us, give us this day our daily bread. And that word bread comes from the root Greek word ero, and it means to lift up. And this is the highway of holiness. You have got to comprehend the highway of holiness is the higher way of thinking. Moses knew God's ways, and the people of Israel only knew his acts. Why? Because they were far away from him. They only wanted a visitation if they knew it made no requirement for them to be consecrated before his visitation. They didn't want it if it brought inconvenience. Do you understand this, saints of God? It is convenient to show up to a prayer meeting and to say we need to repent and to say we need to be consecrated and to pray that. And there is nothing wrong with that if it is earnest. And there are earnest people that pray that all the time. But this is the thing, and this is what God had me post last week, and he keeps bringing it to my person. He says, Robin, people are acting. People are acting. Don't just think because someone says something. And listen, be that way about me. Don't just think because I say a thing. Don't just take it for granted. We have all got to be circumspect. And I'm not saying that I'm acting. I'm not saying that. But I'm saying that we are not to esteem. We're not to hold in high esteem man or woman. We are only to hold one name in esteem, and that is the Son of God, Jesus Christ. That is the only name that is in this earth born of man, born of woman, that we are to esteem is Jesus Christ. And this is where the trouble is in this hour, is that people are getting their eyes lifted up to the ways of the enemy, where there looks like there's a wealthiness, but there is friendship with this world, and that is enmity with God. And God is waking us up, and He's shaking us, and He's telling us to be earnest, to covet not the things of this world, but to covet Christ Jesus. Am I grateful for what the Father has done for me? Absolutely. And I praise Him. Listen, the blessings that we are seeing now, to other people, they might not look like much. To Rich and I, we feel like we're millionaires. It is not millionaire stuff. It is the smallest stuff. But understand, we are so grateful. And to us, we feel so blessed. And we feel wealthy because we know we could not have done even the smallest of things that God has done in our life. And we are living modestly, and we feel like millionaires. We don't have to have the things of this world to feel rich. We are rich in relationship first with God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. And we are rich in relationship in our marriage, where we have a friendship, and we are rich in relationship with our sons. My sons that have become richest sons, we are rich in relationships. We're rich in fellowships. Woo! Because we see others through the lens of Christ. And there is no richer thing that you can have on this earth than to have the mind of Christ. 1 Corinthians 2:16. To have the mind of Christ, the intentions, the thoughts of the Father, to know His ways. Woo! Isaiah 11:3-5, where you don't judge by your own hearing or your own seeing, but with righteousness, hallelujah, you distribute equity to the poor, to the downtrodden, to the meek, and by the rod of His word, you smite the oppressor, hallelujah, because your delight is in the fear of the Lord, and He makes you have quick ruach, quick understanding of the fear of the Lord. That is Isaiah 11:3-5. Do you understand? Jesus did not come in pomp. He didn't come with glitter. He didn't come with gold. He didn't come with jewels. Jesus came as a humble servant. Oh, but there is one who has a lot of pomp, who came with gold, who came with jewels, and that is called Lucifer. We see that in Scripture. Do you understand? It is only the Holy Spirit that can open your eyes to truly discern, to see. And the way in which He does it is by showing you your fruit, showing you the examination of your heart. Listen, say to God, it cannot be emphasized. I see this so much where people are trying to be someone else. Listen, do not try to be someone else. Do not get ahead of God. Do not. The Father has a destiny, a hope for you, but you have to be willing to go through the sifting. I have so many people that want to be where Holy Spirit has someone else, and they compare themselves to that person, but they have not been sifted like that person has been sifted. They weren't. Do you understand why God used Peter in Acts 2? Well, he was the chosen vessel of mercy created for God's glory, because Peter was so sifted. And understand this, saints of God, it was his sifting and his being lifted up into a higher way of thinking in the love of the Father. It was like that road to Damascus, that Isaiah 6 experienced to know the love of the Father, because he knew his own unworthiness. He knew he wasn't worthy. But because of the love of Christ, hallelujah, he has been made worthy, not because of himself, but because God created him and loved him. And God uses the foolish things. He uses those that are sifted. And he uses that sifting to do what? Strengthen the brethren. Strengthen the brethren. Strengthen the church. Saints, this is where we are. If you are being sifted, you praise God. You thank God. You resist the accuser. You resist the slanderer. You do not receive a spirit of condemnation. And you just keep your eyes on Jesus Christ and you be lifted up into that wealth and the riches of the glory of the righteousness of Christ Jesus, to know the abundance of Christ inside of you, the hope of glory. Do you understand that Greek word glory is doxa? And it indicates glory. It also indicates judgment. And it comes from the Greek word dokeo. And it means an opinion and a thought. Saints of God, this is the higher way, the holy way, the highway of holiness, is to have 1 Corinthians 2:16, the mind of Christ. And that mind of Christ doesn't judge by our own eyes or our own hearing, but that mind of Christ in us is the transformed mind, Romans 12:2, that knows God's ways in Jesus' name. So I pray, saints of God, for that eye salve to be upon us, and that God just remove the scales off of our eyes, anything in ourselves that we have leaned on is trying to justify and make excuses for our actions, and that we don't do it, but we surrender, we submit, we do not try to cover ourselves up, but we submit to that word of God that is dividing between our hearts, that's doing surgery and it's operating on our hearts, and it's dividing between soul and spirit. And we submit to that as God prunes us of that which is unclean, and he causes us to bear more excellent fruit to glorify the Father in Jesus' name, amen, and opens our eyes to see the crowding of the kingdom of heaven, its fruit that is surrounding us. So we see it, we seize it, and we eat it in Jesus' name, to know that we can taste and see that God is good in Jesus' name, amen. I love you, God bless you, and get ready for the Feast of Tabernacles, Sukkot, in Jesus' name, amen. I love you.